Good morning, everybody. Your Holiness, and the eminent scientists and guests coming from various parts of the world, Buddhist scholars, students, and lay community and students. It is my great privilege and joy to welcome all of you here on behalf of the Dalai Lama Trust India and the Library of Tibetan Works and Archives. As we are all aware that this initiative, based on His Holiness's encouragement and vision, has been taking place for many years, and I'm grateful that many of you, the eminent scientists, have been constantly supporting this program. The exchange and dialogue that we have together is not one to show or display who has greater knowledge, but it is a meeting to explore the depth and the richness of each other's tradition, and thereby to see how we can best use those knowledges for the peace, harmony, and well-being of at least mankind, if we don't talk about all sentient beings. I'm particularly happy that this important meeting, with the presence of His Holiness the Dalai Lama, is taking place today in this monastic environment, which we can proudly say is the living Nalanda Monastic University. It's a historic meeting taking place in such an important Buddhist learning center. I am overjoyed that so many of scholars are here to share your wisdom. And during this gathering, the organizers have tried our best to arrange things that are needed. Not only we have around 800 or 900 people listening and participating with His Holiness, but we have also arranged in a bigger hall in the new Losiling Assembly Hall, which can accommodate around 10,000 people, And also in the old Losaling temple, we have also arranged exhibition on the five senses. And I'm glad that Richie is also doing his presentation in the evenings. And then we also have evening talks by eminent scholars from 7:30 to 9. As His Holiness, you have very kindly and repeatedly mentioned that this is the time to open up, not to remain confined in small traditions and disciplines, to explore those resources which can contribute to the well-being of the whole humanity without being bogged down in one small denominations. His Holiness has very kindly mentioned that a kind of secular ethics based on common sense, common experience, scientific finding must be used to enrich the inner value which is so much needed today. Therefore, you are making a great contribution. Some people sometimes ask me, what did we achieve by all these Mind Life conferences? There are so many things that we have achieved, but sometimes it is difficult to pinpoint one thing and say, this is what we have achieved, like a construction of a building. But the transforming the person and changing the perspective and developing a global or worldwide outlook and share this closeness together is the only solution for many of the sufferings and illnesses of the world. Therefore, I'm very grateful to all of you who are participating. And of course, I have no words for His Holiness for your initiative and vision. And during your stay, I hope you have a happy stay. And if there are anything we can do, I'm the person to complain. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Your Holiness.
Oh, yes.
Your Holiness, Geshe Lakhdar, esteemed colleagues, and all those who are participating in these critical conversations between Buddhist thought and science, it is both an honor and a privilege for us to be here representing the Mind and Life Institute and to work together with Your Holiness once again. I'd like to begin by acknowledging and thanking three major sponsors of this gathering. First, the Dalai Lama Trust of India, who has been a local patron and funder and a co-sponsor of this event. They have been generous in their support. In addition, the Library of Tibetan Works and Archives has been a local co-host. And finally, also Barry and Connie Hershey and the Hershey Family Foundation has been generous in their support of this meeting, as they have in so many other meetings. And on behalf of the scientists, and I feel all of us, we can thank these individuals and organizations for their generosity. You know, over 25 years ago, Your Holiness, Francisco Varela, Adam Engel, and a group of scientists came together to hold the very first Mind and Life Conference, a dialogue with you in Dharamsala. Since that time, the work of the Mind and Life Institute, of which you are co-founder and honorary chair, has grown to include many thousands of scientists, scholars, and contemplative practitioners, as well as other organizations such as Emory University, Stanford University, the University of Wisconsin, Amherst College, and the Science for Monks program, with the support of the Sager Foundation, which is represented here by the Sager family. During the last 25 years, we from the Mind and Life Institute have often gathered together as scientists, scholars, philosophers, and contemplative practitioners in your residence, in your other home in Dharamsala, India. Not so many people, but we've been there very often to discuss important questions concerning the nature of reality, the nature of consciousness, meditation, and the like. Now this week we're gathered together once again, but now with thousands of teachers, scholars, students from your Tibetan Buddhist monastic universities. We come here from the US, from Europe, Nepal, India, in order to help initiate what is a very important new program of study, in particular the introduction of modern science into the monastic curriculum. I think the decision to include science in your curriculum is a courageous decision. It took courage. For centuries, you have taught a curriculum without science, without modern science. So you must be asking yourselves, why now bring science into our teaching and our learning? Some must be concerned and worried that science will somehow deflect the aspiring monk or nun from his or her path, a path that was first walked by the Buddha. You are all still pupils of that remarkable teacher who taught us the way through suffering to genuine happiness. What does modern physics, neuroscience, and the study of consciousness have to do with the Four Noble Truths and the Eightfold Way? Yet it is my deep and firm conviction It is my deep and firm conviction, just a second. Okay.
I'm okay.
Okay. They're distributing FM radios to those who need to have a translation of this going out over FM radio. So they're bringing them in. So we can ask, what does modern science have to do with the great teachings of the Buddha? It's my deep and firm conviction that science need not be a hindrance or an obstacle in any way or a distraction from the noble work that you are doing in the monastic universities of Drepung, Ganden, and the other great universities of Buddhist thought. In fact, if we take up the challenge of modern science properly, with philosophical sophistication, it does not lead to materialism, but actually to a fuller insight into reality. And I hope in these days ahead, this becomes clear to each and every one of you. In fact, I believe it is only by a union of science and contemplative spirituality that humanity will actually find its best way forward. You know, as I walk through the streets here, crowded with monks, and I see the beautiful buildings that you have for your monastic universities, or watch in admiration the vigor of the debates in the wide open courtyards, yes, we saw the debates, right? We heard the debates. We admired the vigor, the drama of those debates, and we hear the chanting and the memorization and recitation of sacred texts. When I experienced all this, I was reminded of my own experience very far from here, 40 years ago, when I was a student at my university with 35,000 other students on a beautiful campus, studying physics and chemistry, mathematics and electronics, and only a little philosophy, I'm afraid. Yet as much as I loved those subjects of science, as much as I cared for them, I was profoundly unhappy and considered actually leaving and quitting my studies. Why? Because the outer learning of the sciences, as noble as it is, did not satisfy my deepest inner yearning. It was only when I met a scientist who was also a meditator and spiritual philosopher that I had a picture, an image of what was possible, how to become a whole human being. So only when science and spirituality meet, and they met in me, then I felt I was on the road to a true insight and compassion, only by the joining of those two. And so for the last 40 years, I've been on that path. It weaves together the threads of contemplation and scholarship, scientific research into a beautiful tapestry, a cloth, a tanka. And the story it tells is the story of my life of science and spirituality together at the same time. And it is for this reason that I am here today. If I'd chosen only one way, the way of science, why would we talk? But having chosen in my own way to find the relationship between these two, I come here. Science may well challenge our normal ideas and concepts of reality, but it need never be a hindrance to your and to my spiritual striving and small accomplishments. And so, as in all of our meetings with you, Your Holiness, we come here not as Buddhists, Christians, Jews, or Muslims, not as believers or non-believers. We come as open-minded, inquiring human beings who, like you and all who are hearing my voice, are seeking after truth, after reality. As scientists, we follow the evidence of the senses and the reasoning of the mind, wherever it may lead us. In addition, we have learned how important and powerful the effects of meditation can be, changing and transforming the very mind and the way we see the world around us. We do our research in laboratories and libraries. We research not out of idle curiosity, but because we also feel that insight and real understanding of ourselves and our world will benefit humanity. And so as scientists and philosophers, we believe that insight dispels ignorance and relieves suffering. Finally, we come here to learn, as well as to share what we understand. Because by integrating the insights of Buddhist philosophical thought and meditation with the understandings of science, we stand the very best chance of reaching our human goal of alleviating suffering and promoting human flourishing. So in the days ahead, may our thoughts reflect the greatest wisdom of our two traditions. May our words be spoken with humility and clarity and integrity. And may our actions be born out of the faithful friendship that has been the hallmark of the last 25 years of dialogue and mutual investigation between you and the Mind and Life Institute. And may the work we do this week not only aid your monastic community and Your Holiness, but also the entire world and all sentient beings. I'd like to invite now Richie Davidson to say a few words also of appreciation and acknowledgement.
Thank you.
We have Richie's mic on, please.
I'll look you.
That's good. Your Holiness, it is an honor and a privilege for us to be with you in this setting today. When we first arrived here at the Drepung Monastery, Jimpala took us for a tour the first evening, and it was inspiring to be with him, having been a student, Jimpala being a student here for so many years, to see his return to this location and the very fact of holding a Mind and Life dialogue here is something that is really a very momentous occasion, not just for your community, Your Holiness, but for us as scholars and scientists as well. We come with I think, a very deep motivation to understand the true nature of reality, in the understanding that that insight will help us to benefit other human beings. This motivation is something that really is a core part of our work, and one of the things that you have helped so many scientists, Your Holiness, to understand is that by combining the methods and the insights from the contemplative traditions with those of modern science, we have a better opportunity to have a more complete understanding. And that is something, I think, which has helped us as scientists to cultivate more humility about how much we don't know. And this has been so important in expanding our horizons of the research that lies ahead, the questions and challenges that we still need to address in our work as we go forward. The dialogues that we have been having, we believe, have already had tremendous benefit in the West. We see benefit in major institutions of our culture. We see that the healthcare industry, that education, both of these major institutions have become so much more receptive to the importance of contemplative practice in each of these domains. And in large part, I think, it is from the research that has been spawned by the Mind and Life Institute. At a very momentous meeting in Dharamsala in the year 2000, Your Holiness challenged us to take this and really to start doing real research on this. Up until that point, there had been many dialogues which have laid an important foundation, but the research really hadn't begun. And you, I think, in your vision, saw the possibility that research of this kind could be of benefit. We then had several public meetings that helped to catalyze the Western scientific community around some of these ideas, and research then began to actually unfold, and many of those studies have now been published in some of the most prestigious scientific journals in the West. That sequence, those events, have been tremendously catalytic in opening up new areas of scientific investigation that many never believed would be possible, at least so quickly. We now have a field that is emerging that we call contemplative neuroscience. And Your Holiness has played such an important role in inspiring particularly the young people who come to the scientific education process with a realization that scientific methods and the scientific enterprise as it's been conducted in the West, while very successful, is not necessarily complete. And Mind and Life has played an important role in providing a home for these young people to a community in which other like-minded individuals are pursuing these types of investigations. And this has been just such a meaningful part of their life, and I don't think they would be successful without the collective activity that we've all been engaged. Universities today, major universities, are actually interested in hiring new faculty who have research interests in areas such as the application of mindfulness-based practices in healthcare, in treating psychiatric disorders like depression. It is something that is becoming more and more mainstream. The National Institutes of Health, which is the largest healthcare funding agency in the world, is now giving more than $150 million a year to research on the impact of meditation on health conditions. And I think, again, we see this tremendously rapid change that none of us, I think, expected to occur in the way it has unfolded. One of the things that scientists often do when they write a scientific paper after conducting some basic research is in the last few sentences of the paper, they say that these findings may be someday important for benefiting other human beings, for helping to relieve suffering. And I think that Your Holiness has helped us to bring the practical import of this work to right in the center of what we're doing. And we are now collectively, as a field, beginning to do research where, in the process of doing the research, we are benefiting people in real contexts by applying some of the methods from the contemplative traditions in ways that could help people and at the same time conduct our scientific investigations. It's been thrilling for us just in the short time we've been here already to see to get a sense of the possibilities of more significant interaction between our traditions. Last night, when we observed the debate, Jimpala was translating some of it for us, and some of the issues that were being discussed are actually issues about which scientific research has something to say. And I asked Jimpala whether he can envision a time when the debaters would actually bring up scientific evidence as part of their response. I think that we are beginning to see the start of it, the foundation of it, here today with this meeting. And it is with tremendous honor and respect that we are here today. And I'd like to thank Your Holiness for inspiring us with this vision.
Your Holiness, would you like to offer some words?
His Holiness would speak in Tibetan. So those who have FM radios, you can listen to this. And those who don't, I think we'll have to huddle. And we will have a couple of interpreters who will do simultaneous translations. So I think you could pass on the
Now, since the major proportion of the audience is the Tibetan monks, scholars, perhaps I think my explanation also, you see, need some sort of depth. Therefore, I prefer use my own mother tongue. You know, sometimes it's a certain complicated subject. My broken English, the vocabulary is not adequate. So sometimes, you see, the rich Buddhist concept of Buddhist philosophy, through my broken English, then the philosophy or concept itself become very poor. So, Okay. Test.
It's Tibetan.
Tibetan now.
Do you hear me?
Okay.
Do you hear the English translation?
Yes.
Okay, yes. So you have to tune it to number 92, FM 92.
Jode, I think you also can help. Nigi.
And Ratu Kenbucho. Oh, His Holiness is asking Ratu Abbot Nikki to assist in translating to the scholars around him. So today here in the presence of the Ganden Tirumbuche at this great learning center with so many scholars. And I also heard that there are many secular students from the nearby secular schools. I see them there. So that's why I thought that it would be better for me to speak in Tibetan. On the one hand, the place where we are convening this conference is this is usually referred to as the second Nalanda of ancient India. So this is considered to be the second Nalanda of Tibet after the first Nalanda in India. Ever since the second Dalai Lama, Drepung has had a special connection with the series of Dalai Lamas and has been the main learning center of the lineage of the Dalai Lamas. And today here, as a part of the monastic institution associated with the lineage or the line of Dalai Lamas, as a member of the lineage, I to those of you from the West and foreign countries, particularly the scientists and scholars here, to all of you here. Here to the audience, led by the Ganden Tirumbuche and his two deputy designated successors, on behalf of all of them, I greet our Western scholars and scientists who are gathered here, and welcome you here. Yesterday when we had a brief meeting on the upper story, I jokingly shared with you saying the second Nalanda, the seat of learning of Tibet. Here we are going to meet with materialists who have been specially invited here, but what is different is that what is different from the kind of materialist we used to meet early on is that here the members here are not insistent on their positions as used to be the case with other materialists we the ancient Buddhists used to meet with. Rather, you are very special in being very open-minded and always open to whatever unfolds in the process of the investigation, never coming up with a given agenda and insist on it, but rather feel very open. So in 400 verses by Aryadeva, he comes up with three qualities required of students or required of people aspirant. The first one is the sense of impartiality, and this is one you all fulfill, in that you are very impartial in how you proceed with your investigation. You do not come up with a set in stone position that you are anyhow going to stick to irrespective. That's not the case with you, so you are open-minded in that, impartial. And then the other is intelligence, one who is equipped with intelligence, one who is equipped with insight. In this regard, you are again fulfill this quality of being intelligent and rational in that in whatever you approach for investigation. This is the way you have been trained for long, and this is how you pursue your search for truth, in that you pursue it with impartiality, equipped with, conjoined with a sense of sense of rationality, sense of intelligence, sense of intellect. And then the third one is enthusiasm. Among the scientists here whom I have acquired acquaintance for these so many years, even from among the community of scientists also, you could be said to be a subset within them, that you are not necessarily content with whatever you have found, but rather searching for more, and rather make what you understand more complete. Confining oneself with mere, outside-oriented investigation, in the wake of which one becomes oblivious of who oneself is, what one one undergoes in terms of experiences. Rather, you among those who have pursued your investigation to the point that now you have come up with this sense of affirmation that whatever you do, you should be able to benefit the welfare of others, as well as should be oriented inside in terms of how it is connected with the practical experience that one gains from that. So I personally very sincerely think that you all fulfill all these three requisites that Aryadeva came up with for a genuine student. I am known for my frankness, and those among us within the monastic community, we sometimes tend to rely more on scriptural authority. Although in the case of Vinaya, monastic precepts as Vinaya and Abhidhamma, of course one could make an excuse that that's the area where one might have to rely on spiritual authority as much. But in the case of Mahadharmika, the middle way philosophy, in the case of epistemology and whatnot, that should not be the case. So there one should be very clear in how to pursue the search by relying more on rationality. If the subject of investigation is what we call extremely hidden, then there might be an exception that there the direct reasoning might be scripturally oriented. But there too, one has to build the basic foundation for allegiance to those statements on the basis of one's evidence and findings, supported by rationality. So in this case, sometimes even the scientists might excel us in their being so impartial and rational oriented. And then another thing is that very often we find, some, after pursuing their studies, they do not seem to have pursued it with a sense of benefiting others, although there may be many who would pursue it so, but not everyone pursues it this way. And thus, what becomes very evident is that at the point they finish their studies, then they right away take off to the Western countries and then use whatever their understandings to earning dollars, to earning money, material possessions. So that's sometimes the case with some students, although that's not the case, of course, for everyone, because we have seen through the course of history that so many wonderful masters with benevolence core at their heart have been produced and have served humanity on a large scale through their own practice, through their own teachings and whatnot. So that's how I see those of you who are present here and others associated with you fulfill those three qualities of being a genuine student, a qualified student. So you are special in that you still maintain intact your scientific standpoint in pursuing the search through a scientific rigor and scientific perspective. Yet at the same time, you have this additional perspective of being oriented inward and looking for how what you learn and what you investigate is then connected to becoming a better person in terms of making inner improvement. I wanted to make this point very clear because otherwise people might come with this feeling that His Holiness himself has started giving up on some principles of the Buddhist, including acceptance of Mount Meru, etc., and that now he is not only giving it to himself, but rather expanding it to others and on a larger scale to the Sajjama monastery and making everyone kind of go in that direction. So that's not the case. Now it has been for some time. If we look back to the history of mankind, we see how when people meet with difficulties, seeing that the problems before them are overwhelming, that they would resort to look for some power beyond them. That's how faith into supernatural phenomena happened, and that's how people carried on for the next 4,000, 5,000 years. And then eventually people began to investigate a little more and thereby exerting their own potential more. And through that, they use tools to investigate their field of search. In this regard, I see a parallel between the Buddhists and the scientists, in that in Buddhist teachings we have the presentation of the four kinds of reasonings, of which one is that of natural reasoning. Natural reasoning in that one has to allude to the natural working of phenomena, and based on that, then we come up with the additional reasonings, such as that of the function and that of the validity, reasonability, etc. So, in terms of the tools that we use, it seems like we have a parallel ground there. But in the case of scientists, although they seem to basically touch base with these four strengths of rationality, strengths of reasoning, but have over the course of time improved on that and have improved on the implements and have even advanced them so that their field of search could be pushed a little beyond the apparent and thus be able to make more finer researches. At the same time, what has become apparent is that this So over the course of history, what has evolved is that those who primarily rely on faith or primarily rely on belief happen to be associated with the religious institutions, whereas those who pursued science relying mainly on rationality and relying on tools have begun to be more reasoning oriented. But then through the course of the history, what has become apparent that from the scientific community pursuing reason and material evidences, they also experience inner distortion, inner imbalances. And because of that, being felt at the on the individual level, that expands out, is reflected on the society, and thus in the society, several evidences of social unrest have become apparent, have become spread out. Through that, people have been forced to kind of reflect back into themselves in terms of what causes these, and this has people concerned in this area, more particularly the scientific community, to kind of orient themselves more into developing the inner values, inner qualities for which inspirations are found in religious teachings across the board, not necessarily confined to one particular religion. And this is my part individual belief also. I sincerely believe that all the religious traditions, major religious traditions, particularly those who are backed with philosophical background, have that potential to serve humanity in that respect of building our inner values. But then, from among them, those traditions, those religious traditions found in the East, which primarily have very rich teaching sources in developing serenity, in developing insight, insightful meditation. They seem to have a special added resource of very rich mental techniques, with a detailed explanation of the workings of the mind, more particularly in terms of understanding the workings of negative emotions, destructive emotions, going into detail of the mechanism of how they arise and how to tackle them. And through that, through because of this reality from the scientific community with their concern led to looking deeper into the science of brain, how the different mental states affect them, change them structurally, functionally, and through that, their attention had been led to these traditions which reach explanation of the workings of mind and mental states. So in this regard, I want to expound more from the Buddhist perspective. Nagarjuna very clearly states that Buddha didn't say that the sufferings are a natural thing that are bound to happen no matter what. That's not the stand. Freedom or freedom of will. Free will.
Or free will. Free will, Janyama.
At the same time, there are other traditions. Well, yes. Nagarjuna is quoted here, where he says that among the schools of thought, they differ in their stand of where the sufferings come. Either they come from their own self, or they come from others, or they come from the combination of thought. But this is not the case with the Buddhists, whereas the Buddhists rather say their stand is that the sufferings come from their own respective causes and conditions, and within the causes and conditions that the sufferings depend on, they come from ignorance, they come from delusion. And that's what the Buddhist stand is. And then the second reasoning, second reflection comes that the delusion has to be addressed. Delusion has to be addressed if one doesn't want suffering. And from among the delusions, there are two types. One is mere knowledge, and the other is a kind of a distorted apprehension. And among the two, the later one is more serious in that it comes up with a more specific mode of apprehension which is distorted and which is not in conformity with the reality. For that, mere prayer is not going to help in changing it, but rather has to be addressed accordingly through coming up with the rightful understanding. In the epistemological teachings, courses, it says that whatever we aspire for, though it can be achieved through the help of a valid cognition. And among the valid cognition-driven benefits, it could be either valid cognition mediated continuously or mediated sporadically, but somehow they are all valid cognition-mediated results. And from among them, the result of overcoming the misknowledge delusion has to come up with a well-informed understanding, from among the distortions or misknowledge with a specific mode of apprehension, one could say that there can be one which involves superimposing some exaggeration, or the other that kind of underrates what the reality is. So again, here with regard to the method of addressing it has to be done accordingly also, not that any kind of valid cognition would do, have to be done accordingly. So thus, every result that we aspire for, more particularly in regard to success in overcoming suffering, has to be valid cognition driven, either mediatedly or either continuously mediatedly by valid cognition or sporadically mediated, but has to be driven somehow by the valid cognition. That's the reason why Buddha has taught his disciples not to rely merely on his words out of devotion, but rather investigate the things for themselves and come to confirmation with regard to the workings of it. And the reason, one specific reason for his urge for investigation, carrying out investigation, is because that even in his own teachings also he deals with the situation accordingly, and not out of whim or not out of impulse, but rather with what would correspond with the situation. So that's how there were teachings which could not be taken literally, and there are others which could be taken literally, and there are others which address just the superficial problem, not the deep deep layers, but others that specifically deal with the deep layers, etc. So that's the reason, even from among the very teachings also, is the need of investigating it further, rather than taking things on the face value. So I think it's in the work of Asanga, where he says that from among the two person and the teachings, one has to rely more on the teaching. On among the teachings, one has to rely not on the words but on the meaning. From among the meaning, one has to rely more on definitive meaning, but not the interpretive meaning. And from among the definitive meanings, then one has to rely more on the wisdom, exalted wisdom, but not on the adventitious knowledges. Although on this regard, some more deliberation need to be done. It is more deeper. But somehow, this very clearly shows that the preference should be in investigating and rely on the finding through such investigation, rather than relying fully or solely on faith. So that's the emphasis there.
These two stations, two things, yeah.
So one thing very clear is the emphasis on relying on reasoning. So for our case also, just as the saying says that it has to be driven through inferences, but inferences ultimately rooted in perception. That's because, of course, that would be the case with the extremely hidden phenomena, and so is the case with the slightly hidden also, that their understanding have to be understanding a reliable understanding have to be driven through reasoning, through rationalization, which would then ultimately be rooted on a perception. So that's how it all boils down to the empirical finding. So that we see that our reasonings, the strength of the reasoning has to be ultimately rooted in perception, the empirical perception. With regard to the field of empirical perception, here the scientists are far ahead in their methods of investigation, in their findings, in their searches, in their involvement, etc. So that's how, in terms of topics like dealing with the working of the special mental states and etc., they have to be rooted in perception, in the sense of what we ourselves experience. So here we see two different types of what might constitute the perceptual field. One that is perceptually seen through the sense faculties, another one which is perceptually experienced within. So far the scientific investigation has of course been rooted or grounded has started their starting point on the perception, but more on the perceptual fields of the sense faculties, not so much on the perceptual experience of the inner consciousness. And that is understandable because that is much more difficult to pursue from there. So that's how, so far, the scientific field of investigation has mainly been confined in this world of the outer world, though rooted in the perception and the perceptual fields through the field faculties. But then, over the course of a year now, things are beginning to change in that their attention is being driven more inward into the empirical perception of the experiences, inner experience of individual, since that has much greater connection with the actual experiences. So in this regard, it may be just a case of where we have emphasized more or not, or where each of the traditions emphasized more or not, but I don't see a contradiction there. There's not a head-on collision there in any way, even in terms of the method, in terms of the pursuit. I don't see any contradiction. I particularly remember very clearly when I personally have been advised, have been talked out of such a conversation or pursuing such a conversation by others, although with sincerity. But I have always been primarily driven by the teaching, by the insight in Buddhism that one has to base one's understanding experience through investigation. So here, whatever investigation you undertake, it has to be geared towards searching the truth. That will have the effect of dispelling one's distortion of the reality, be that in the sense of underestimation or in the sense of overestimation. And in terms of the field of investigation, the Buddhists come up with three major fields of investigation, fields of phenomena. Now, the evident one, the slightly hidden, and the extremely hidden, whereas the scientists so far have mainly been involved with the evident empirical world, leaving out the less evident and the extremely evident ones. But then in this field, the way the scientists have advanced is really impressive, in that, say, in the case of the empirical things, in terms of their being ephemeral and changing and whatnot. The scientists, in the connection with the scientists involved with them, getting involved with them has really helped me in my understanding of the subtle impermanent nature of things, in that through the use of tools in these instruments, I have been even being able to observe the constant influx of things more clearly and more directly. And likewise, so goes the same with the concept of non-self. We have been always been pursuing, pressing that yes, there is no intrinsically independent self out there that could be approached, the light has just gone. Is it still working? Yeah. So even in the case of the concept of non-self, with my involvement with the scientists through their findings in the field of the working of brain, I have really benefited from this, and my understanding on Buddhism has really increased. The only casualty you might call is the belief in Mount Meru. That may be the only casualty, but in terms of all other realms of understanding, I have been really appreciative of this involvement that has really benefited me personally, and likewise the rest of our community could look forward to this. And as we have heard, even from the scientific community, they have acknowledged that they have also benefited from this. So this kind of a convergence, a dialogue has really benefited mutually. So that's the reason why I, from my own experience, from how I personally gained from this, I have been pressing that this could be broadened and institutionalized so that the entire community could get benefit out of that. And in this regard, we have pursued initially with giving scientific teaching, scientific instructions to select a few monastics from different monasteries and whatnot. We have pursued that for the last 4 or 5 years. But now has come a time where we are making the plunge in making it more broad-based. And now, very soon, we are coming to the time when officially the courses in science would be incorporated into the monastic curriculum. And because of this upcoming imminent change, I have proposed that this Mind and Life teaching, Mind and Life conference be convened at the monastic setting. The benefit from that is that just as we have heard from the scientific community, they said that just from the past 2 days of the observation, they have been really impressed with what they have seen. And also they had the opportunity to witness the congregation happening in Ghana, and I personally wish I could come there, but somehow from the persistent teachings that I've been giving over the past many weeks and months, I still don't feel quite well in my throat, so I still feel some hoarse and whatnot. So that's the reason why I could not make there. I gathered from the scientists that apparently you had discussed the conception of self, as the focus of debate last night, which they observed. And as we saw them bring this up in their observation. Now, in this regard, one thing very Yeah, one thing interesting about the conception of self is that irrespective of whether a particular religion come up so pronounced and so refined in terms of what it is constituted of, how to address that or whatnot, because either directly or indirectly they do seem to address this conception of self-centeredness, of this conception of holding on to an absolute concept of oneself. But one thing special about Buddhism is that it has a very pronounced, a very refined understanding of what constitutes this conception of self, how, what are its implications, how are the ways of addressing it, and how that would have the impact of advancing one's welfare. So this is the particular, the specific about Buddhism. In the case of the monastic community here, the people have been pursuing their studies years after year, and some have been very, very successful in this. But one thing that I want to remind them is that the way that we have come to preserve the tradition of Nalanda is through the combination of study, reflection, and meditation, and that's the main way how we have preserved it. And I hope that through your through your observation, I hope that this will become more evident. Like at the same time, I also hope that through these deliberations, by witnessing this dialogue, I very much hope that the monks would come out with the impression that the scientists too are involved with very profound topics in their observation, in their investigation, and would have some sense of what might have been going on in the past many years in Dharamsala, in the past many years in Dharamsala, in terms of the dialogues. So that's the reason why I have proposed for this meeting to be held here.
Oh, thank you. However, all the scientists with their full dedications, with the interest, they have come here from far away. And this meeting with great scientists and how it develops, what is the reason behind? And in another sense, I remember very vividly in the year 1955, when I went from Beijing, Mao Zedong, I met Mao Zedong often, many times. And the last date on which I met him, he told me that the way you think, it's like a scientist. You think like a scientist. And then after that, in the year 1960s, in Tibet, there's so many letters which are released from Tibet. And they believe that it's blind faith, all the, you know, the religion, the Buddhism is a blind faith. And then Mozart also said, you know, like the letter came out from Tibet saying that all the belief, the Buddhist philosophy is nothing but a blind faith. So it, you know, the Tibetans, the Buddhism, Tibetan needs to overcome that. Now, that the scientists rail, I'm not talking about the way the Buddhist it's a very different the way the Buddhists learn, the way the monks learn the Buddhist philosophy. It's purely it's like a scientific method. Now they are the real scientists, because now the in Garsha. No, what he meant to say is like the way the monks study, the methodology of how the pedagogy of what the monks study is purely like a scientific method.
Made speechless.
Oh, and then as the science advances, that the many people in the world, long time back, the scholars, they used to say, the Tibetan Buddhist scholars, they used to say that if you study, if you become scholars of the science, if you're good in science, that means you won't be able to, those people who said, who are good in science will not be able to understand the Buddhist philosophy, now they have been made tongue-tied. Earlier, they used to believe that those people who study science, the monks who study science, will not be able to explain, especially during the debating and all dialectic, they won't be able to get a win over the opponents. And the many say that, okay, if the science develops, then Buddhism will decline. And one of the reasons is the first time when I met with the scientists, I had two objectives. I have two. I always said I have two objectives. My first objective is my knowledge, okay, to expand our knowledge. There's no judgment, which one is good or which one is bad. It's non-judgmental. For example, in the Buddhist philosophy, when you wanted to study it, okay, when you comes to the practice, when you want to study the subjective knowledge, there's no question of, you have to find the reality. You have to find the reality, the objective. There's no question of judgmental. You have to really study, okay, without any bias. So the first objective why I learned science is our knowledge. Till now, the scientists have really, objectively, they have studied in depth. Now they are studying deeply. And then not only that, they are also studying the human emotions and the different emotions and how it's been functional, how it is related to the object, the relationship between the subjective and the objective. And the second aim why I've interacted with the scientist is because when you study the objectives and the chemicals, after studying and learning, then what is the beneficial aspects of all these signs we will try to get? For example, medicine, where they have studied the human body, and later on they found out the benefits of all this medical research, and then they expand the knowledge, and then those which are harmful, they reduce it, and they try to block it, they try to stop it, and because of that, because of the chemical analysis, chemical reaction, and this is the second. And the second one there, you have to have a judgment, you have to decide which one is better, which is good. Like that, when you think about the consciousness and the emotions, when you go deep, When you start understanding what is, we are not talking about the life after death, we are not talking about the nirvana, we are not talking about whether you are up there to, okay, the God, realm of God, in this life, in this world, we want this world, in this whole world, to have a better world, more peaceful world, and a happier world. And when you start understanding the emotions and the consciousness, and what is the root cause of what makes the happiness, what is the main root cause of is a root cause of suffering, and that we have to know, and then we should have the antidote for that, and try to that the causes we try to reduce it, resist it, and then we to try to find out, subdue all those negative emotions, afflictive emotions, and then try to find the better. I have many friends, they have highly expert and highly known, but the scientists who are brain neuroscientists, they are expert scholars, but they himself, but personally, it's a very unhappy, and I had lots of worries. I had That's why. So I have the scientists, I have met many scientists who are well-known, you know, the emotions, when they start understanding the broad mind, they have to, it is really helpful, the individual scientists, when they start understanding the different aspects of emotions, then it helps the scientists themselves personally to become a better person and more peaceful person. So it's a big problem if the scientist who has a problem, emotional problem, if they work in the laboratory, the result will not be good. A scientist who is well at ease, who is at peace and who is composed, when they work in scientific research, I think it will be a greater research. Research will be more productive. Tati pyoge nalo pakyo nangu du tanda kongdu shubu na shire kesi tsiriba ngune tada shi tubu chi 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 yobayi na ki takshi cheba imna takshi chi du tsambaya ngune tane jiani gata dumdiya sangbu tuyen tukura di mebe gita tukpa namdo da pusu tokbu chi ki tsiriba takshi cheba imba ina toma dila karchi gu tanda tsiriba koranga shi tubu chi sem lulu chi gogu yore sa shi ne ani chi ne susu ke shi ngubu di korala shi sha chi chan takshi biyabu chi tukura esa di indi tsambaya yu di takshi cheba la yu jing koregi sem da dunzul lulu chi ta dinda gogu yore esa tanda tsiriba lo shun shun mangbu chi duwa kenaan zuki susu gerke nyongwa dunzu tsangma di nyamnyo tsangma la tu bet shi eche dinde tu ne kari shi e tukure shu yubayi bayi na bena che shena diri kangsa ju yubayi bayi na tsiriba ju bayi na an dine gya tamba che an dine gya ne zine ya ma ta pa gyur ma pel ge ching che che an dine tongda mangbu ching che che an dine saye dine mangbu ching che an dine tenpo dinde la pa ching che di kyab do gore esi jawa sangbu di His Holiness used to give an example when you drop a stone into the ocean, the wave, the transverse wave, you know, it moves and it expands. Like that, he's giving an example. All the benefits that you
get. So, that is,
this is my explanation. This is my explanation. So the background of why. Now he said, and again, all the monks, now you know the background, the information, why I had a relationship with them. Now, then, now this is, you have to be careful. For example, when I say that the importance of the science doesn't mean that it's more than 50% of your commitment towards the science only. You have to also have a both. It has to be balanced. So for example, I have lots of interest in science when I was even in Tibet. Even my tutors, you know, I used to tell him that, okay, my tutors, when the senior tutors used to tell me when young, you know, I used to tell them that I'm interested in science, and even they told me, oh, that makes sense. And I said, for example, when I say that I try to meditate on emptiness and compassion, whenever I get a free leisure hours, I used to, you know, my main purpose and the focus is on the meditation, on the compassion, you know. And then maybe some, you know, there's a hub, say those who are, you know, who gets interested in science, who engage in science, and sometimes they neglect the meditations and the Buddhist philosophy. The main, the core, the essence is, you know, like, say, it's like a root, it's about like understanding contemplative studies and the Buddhist philosophy. On top of that, then you study the science. Say, for example, I have no science knowledge. I have no basic knowledge in the science, but still after discussing with the scientist and interactive session with the scientist, then through discussions, then I get some confidence. And then I started studying about these dialectics and then about the middle way. And then it really helps me personally. And then I think it's very important for the monks also, you should consider, while studying science also, do not neglect studying the Buddhist philosophy.
Your Holiness, I'd like to introduce or remind you of Dinah Chapman Walsh, researcher originally at Harvard University, past president of Wellesley College and a major American university, and she will be our facilitator for the day. So I'll give the chair over to her.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Have the microphone on for Dinah Chapman Walsh.
Hello, yeah. There we go. Takes a minute. Thank you so very much. Thanks to each of you for your eloquent and inspiring opening comments, really beautiful opening statements that have positioned us for these 6 days together. It's truly a historic moment. I think we all feel that very keenly, a high intensity moment as we're leaning into our microphones, listening so very carefully to your words. We are just thrilled to be a part of this moment, including we new materialists. I have a new role for myself. I'm a new materialist. The new materialists with our minds opened by science and our minds calmed by contemplative practice. So we come to you having heard these stories this morning of the great personal benefit over these 25 years that have come from these encounters of these two remarkable intellectual traditions. The personal benefits, but also the much closer alignment of our work, those of us who have had the privilege to have these encounters with the Buddhist traditions, with Your Holiness, the closer alignment of our work with real and urgent needs in the world. So it has both of those extraordinary benefits to all the participants, and it's an enormous privilege to be part of it. I won't take time to say more. We've had much to think about. I will be moderating this first day, and I want to call attention, everyone's attention, to the program, because we will be referring to the program, and we won't be taking time from our time together to introduce people at great length or to repeat some of the descriptions that are in these programs. We have two versions of it. One has been carefully translated into Tibet by the Library of the Tibetan Works and Archives in Dharamsala. Geshe Lakdor and his colleagues have taken care of that, so you have a copy of that, and there is an English copy as well. And in those programs are profiles of all the speakers, so you'll be able to refer to those through the week, and descriptions of the topics that will be covered, and also some thoughts about our overall enterprise, as we've just heard. I want to simply call your attention, in both versions of the program, there is on the inside front cover, just as you open it, there is a very beautiful picture of these two gentlemen holding hands and smiling. And I would ask everyone simply to look at that picture, the quotation in which His Holiness says, "We now know that a combination of these two traditions can provide the complete conditions for obtaining real human happiness." And I ask you if there is a better depiction than real human happiness that you've ever seen than this photograph. So I hope we will have many moments such as the one captured in that photograph of wonderful human encounter, of joy in one another's company, of learning new things, each of us, all of us teaching and all of us learning together in this time with joy and pleasure and with great seriousness of purpose as well. It truly is a remarkable opportunity for us all. So my task this morning, I will try to be brief, is just to give you a little sense of the shape and the structure of our program, the intentions that are embedded in the decisions that were made about how we would spend this time together. Everyone who is here has made a serious commitment, a significant commitment of time, and yet it is very brief to cover all of the questions that we hope to at least begin to explore and unearth together. So we've thought carefully about how we can spend our time. And again, you will find this in the program. Each morning, we will begin with a first session, and we're about now to launch into our first session this morning, now that we have had our welcomes and our orientation. Each morning, we will have a first session in the style and the spirit of the Mind and Life Institute dialogues over this quarter century. So, as His Holiness said, he has been off speaking to these scientists, and maybe some of his colleagues in the monasteries are wondering, what has he been up to? So this is an opportunity for all of you to observe firsthand a little bit of the richness of those encounters between His Holiness and other members of the monastic tradition and the scientists from the Western tradition. And we'll do that in just a moment. So every day we'll have the little bit of that as an example, an exemplar. Then every day, the second morning session will be different from that in its intention. It will be more explicitly educational. It will be, in a sense, inaugurating this new era of science education for Tibetan monastics. So we will be celebrating this new era, in a sense, with really exquisite presentations from experts who will bring the distilled essence of their thinking. There won't be time for them to elaborate or explicate in very much detail, but they will try to bring you little gems of what they have learned from their years and years of deep scientific study, and to really give a kind of a ignite everyone's interest and curiosity about that. It will not obviously be the equivalent of many years of study, but we hope it will have that inspirational quality. And we have a very distinguished faculty. Again, you can read about them in your program. And then each day, the third session will be what we're calling an open discussion. It will be an opportunity for questions to come from the floor, both in this hall, and also we have created a method for questions to come from the remote locations. And they can be posed to any of the speakers who have been present that morning. And so I encourage everyone, if you have a question that you would like to pose to His Holiness or to any of the speakers on a given day, think about how to formulate it. And there will be a full hour for that give and take with the audience. And then the fourth session every day after dinner will again be educational in its design and its purpose. So we will have speakers who will again bring a topic and explore it carefully and in a way that those who are not as familiar with it will, we hope, be able to follow and think about its implications. Of course, we hope that everything we do here will be educational in some fundamental sense, educational for all of us, and that, of course, is the great opportunity that we have before us. So the arc of the week in terms of its conceptual organization begins this morning with a more general introductory session, and then the next days we delve more and more deeply into specific topic areas, so physics, neuroscience, and so on. And again, that's well described in the program. There are three minor modifications to the program, as you see it on the back of your booklet, and I want to just explain and bring them to your attention so we won't have any misunderstandings. So first of all, we will have the initial Friday evening speaker will not be here, and so we will have tomorrow night, on Friday evening, we will have a lecture by John Durant on the history of the Earth, and then the following day, Saturday night, a lecture on the history of life. And that's not the way the English program is laid out, although the Tibetan program is correct on that. And that means that on Sunday, we will have an open evening. And we will encourage everyone to go. There will be a beautiful exhibition, and there will also be demonstrations carried on every evening starting tomorrow. But on that Sunday evening, the evening program will be open, and we would encourage everyone to have a chance to see the exhibition, to participate in the demonstrations with the graduate students from the Richie Davidson's laboratory. And then finally, day six, which is our final day, and it's a half day, not a full day, will begin at 8 o'clock in the morning, not 9 o'clock, as it says here, so an hour earlier, and we will end an hour earlier. So the That day and our conference will end at 10 o'clock in the morning on Tuesday, our last day. Finally, on the schedule, instead of waiting until the last day to meet with the women monastics, with the nuns, we are inviting them to join the women in our delegation for a half hour each day, for the last half hour of the lunch period. So that would be from 12:30 until 1 o'clock to join the women who've come from abroad on the second floor in the building next to the Drepung Monastery Hall on the second floor. And we will have that half hour to familiarize ourselves with one another. And we hope then we can have a more continuous interaction with the nuns. So you are all invited if you can hear my voice. So I hope that's clear. If not, please feel free to ask for clarification from any of us. I'm sure, as with all things, there will be further changes. This is an emergent program. Everyone who has been working on it has put enormous amounts of effort in bringing this moment to pass, and yet we are having to make adjustments and will continue to. So we ask for your flexibility, your patience, our patience with ourselves. We will be humble and generous as we proceed. I think there's no question of that. So again, just such an exciting moment. I think we should all take a very deep breath and feel so very grateful that we are here together for these days.
Thank you very much, Diana. Do I have my mic on? Thank you. I'll begin, Your Holiness, and I'll begin first by reminding you that you asked for the content of this Mind and Life event, that there would be three topics. The topics would be modern physics, in particular quantum mechanics, and we'll also weave in some relativity theory. The second topic was neuroscience, which Richie Davidson, Tanya Singer, and others will speak to. And the third topic is consciousness research, which Christoph Koch, Matthew Ricard, and Michelle Bitbo will speak to as well. So this is our scientific program, and we can only, of course, begin what is a huge and challenging field of study, but I hope that the monastics here will get a flavor for these three remarkable fields of modern research, which you have found so interesting. We'll also be speaking at the very end about applications, particularly applications of mindfulness in the areas of clinical work and in education, so that one can see that the fruits of this, what seems to be very abstract, perhaps, study between Buddhist thought and science actually has already shown to have great fruits in the world. I'd like to begin by showing a picture of a very young scientist. This is probably from about 1945, 43, something in there, who made a discovery. Do you recognize the scientist? You tell the story in one of your books of how you looked for the rabbit in the moon. We look for the man in the moon, but you began by looking. This is a very important lesson, that we need to begin by looking. But you not only looked, you began to think about what you saw. You began to apply reason. These two, to look and to reason, are the foundations for science, the foundations for knowledge. And when you looked and reasoned, you saw something that perhaps no other Tibetan had ever seen. You saw that there was a light source, namely the sun, casting a shadow from the mountains on the moon, and you inferred, in the way that you would be then schooled in later, you inferred that there was an external source of light illuminating the moon, casting shadows in this remarkable, beautiful way that you saw as the rabbit in the moon. Not just you, but of course your whole culture. You know, some years earlier in Italy, there was a similar such observation which took place. This is Galileo Galilei. And in 1609, with a telescope which he made himself, you had the 13th Dalai Lama's telescope, I think, so you didn't have to make one. Galileo had to make one because the telescope had only just been invented. And so he put together his telescope and did exactly what you did. He looked, and over 3 weeks, he drew a picture of what he saw were the phases of the moon, the shadows that were cast, and just as you did, he inferred that the moon was moving about the earth, illuminated by the sun, and that there were, in fact, mountains on the moon. Prior to this, people thought that the moon did not have mountains, but he discovered them, you could say, by his seeing and his reasoning. He also looked at other objects in the sky, Jupiter and its moons. He really was one of the most significant and perhaps profoundest of our scientists who changed the entire history of Western scientific investigation. Now, in 1633, so some years later, the church, the Catholic Church, put him on trial for heresy. Because, because what he saw and what he reasoned was contrary to religious belief. He refused to really recant. He refused to deny his inferences, and he stayed with what he saw was the truth. They threatened him with torture, with death, and finally, they put him into prison. Through the intervention of a friend, they made him stay in his house. And so the last 9 years of his life, for these truths, he was confined to his own small house. I see you haven't been confined to your small house. You haven't been tried for heresy. But the Dalai Lama's name gives you a certain privilege, yes. But I hope that many, many other monks and nuns will look through the telescopes and will also reason about what they saw. I tell these two stories not only because they're so similar. Yes, yes, here. He has to turn it on. It's now off. Yeah, exactly. I can see by the way you're looking at the microphone that you have great interest in electronics.
Same,
Like if you have not heard, then I'm going to explain. Most probably in the year 1958, most probably 58 or 57, the previous Dalai Lama's, there's a huge telescope, and I used to go out during the daytime, especially when I was on the roof of the potala, then I used to view through the telescope, and there's nothing else to view. And when in Nubalinga, there's a place called Namdegong, the moon. I used to view the moon and the moon and the stars, moon and the stars. Moons and stars, I used to go up on Nubling. I don't believe that there's a moon. I mean, wrap it up on the moon. But when I look, view through the telescope to the moon, you know, the mountains. The dried lake, and then from the side, the mountain ranges, and during the night when I viewed, when the sun sets, and the reflection of the sun rays falls, and then the directions of the shadows towards the east, sees the changes in the shadows there on the moon. Then he concluded that, you know, it's all because of the reflection of the sun rays up there. Oh, thank you. One evening it was bright. And then the tutor got confirmed, you know, believe in. He agreed what I said. Just now you have explained about comparatively to the Galileos, and now I've realized in it. Yeah. Till now. Otherwise, the many people might, you know, the fanatics might,
Preliminary practices which involve making mandala offerings, so offering the whole universe, and the conception of the universe is based on the Abhidhamma with the Mount Meru in the middle. So when the Dalai Lama says there is no such thing as Mount Meru, some people might think, what is his business? You know, talking, we're doing this practice and he's saying that Mount Meru doesn't exist.
Quite sufficient sort of reasons to give punishment. Okay, sorry.
Thank you. I tell this story because the relationship between science and religion is perhaps one of the most important relationships in civilization. Alfred North Whitehead was one of America's and England's most important philosophers. And in 1925, so, you know, nearly a century ago, he said this about the relationship between the two of these. He said, when we consider what religion is for mankind, how important it has been, how religion has been so important, and what science is also profoundly important. It is no exaggeration to say that the future course of history depends upon the decision of this generation as to the relations between them. The course of history will be determined by whether we come to a right relationship or a wrong relationship between religion and science. And I think, Your Holiness, that this is one of the great public services, a kind of task that you have done, a kind of achievement, that through your person you have convened scientists with contemplative scholars and practitioners, that religion and science have come together on a common ground in a way that has not led to prison, but has led to enlightenment in some small way. I think this cannot be exaggerated in its importance. This is perhaps not fully evident here in this monastic community, but your work in the West, in Europe, the United States in particular, has given an entirely different picture of how religion and science can come together as friends. We need not be enemies. We need not fight with one another, much less put each other in prison. And this quote, which Diana Chapman Walsh read in part, for me brings these two together in exactly the right way, where one says, not so long ago, think of Galileo, many people viewed science as objective knowledge and the subjective understanding of Buddhist inner science as mutually exclusive. But a combination of these two can provide the complete conditions for attaining real human happiness. As a consequence, Mind and Life has taken up this really exciting and profoundly important task of bringing these two worlds together in a way that does provide positive progress towards human flourishing. It has done so by publications of the dialogues which we've had together, so that they do not remain only among a small number. And in 2003, you'll remember, Your Holiness, that we had an important meeting at MIT, the first public meeting at which some of the research that Richie was describing was presented. The interest that came from that meeting, especially by young people, young scientists, was enormous. As a consequence, we started the Summer Research Institute, primarily for young scholars, scientists, and it's an integrated program of research topics and meditation, East and West, contemplative and scientific. We also started Young Investigators Awards, the Francisco Varela Awards. You remember not long ago we were together in Rochester and you had an opportunity to meet six of these remarkable young scientists. And so these are the fruits of that work we've done together, fruits that have been cared for by the Board of Trustees of the Mind and Life Institute, with whom you periodically meet and give counsel on what it is we undertake. I'd like to stop here by way of introduction and by way also of kind of a gratitude, a deep gratitude for your leadership, not only of this monastic community, but your leadership on a world issue, a problem which really confronts the entire globe going forward. I know you do this in modesty and you do this with great humor and joy, but you should know that we understand its significance. Now Richie Davidson will join his words to mine and speak a few thoughts concerning, well, we'll find out.
You can, Arthur, you can stay here because you're going to continue, right?
No, we haven't, don't have the time.
Oh, okay, I see. Okay, switch.
Oops.
Your Holiness, one of the themes that you have requested that we consider at our time together is the theme of neuroscience and also a related theme of consciousness. These themes have been a part of the Mind and Life dialogues from the very beginning. And with all due respect to my wonderful colleagues in physics, I think that the practical consequences of the dialogue with neuroscience have been very evident in the stimulation of actual research, which has been very exciting and I think extremely important for so many different areas. And I'd like to begin by just asking the question, why has neuroscience been such a vibrant opportunity for the dialogue between science and Buddhism? And I think that at its very root, many of the questions that have been historically among the most important in certain branches of neuroscience are really questions that also, I think, are central to Buddhism. Questions such as, is there a self? Where might it be located? Questions like, is all thought conceptual? What is the difference between, or the relation between, perception and cognition? What is the difference between afflictive? So regarding the issue of perception and cognition, one of the questions that neuroscientists have been particularly concerned with is the extent to which the brain provides a faithful and veridical representation of the external world. Or is it more the case that the brain constructs reality in some way? This is a question that we'll be hearing more about over the course of this week. Some of the implications of neuroscientific research related to that question will become apparent. Also, a question that you frequently ask, Your Holiness, what is the difference between non-conceptual and conceptual mental activity? And is there a difference in the brain where we can distinguish between them? It's a question that scientists, neuroscientists, are beginning to ask as well. Also the question of whether there is a difference and what the difference might be between afflictive and non-afflictive emotions has been very central. But I think perhaps the most important issue is that I think that we could say that the third noble truth in Buddhism, really, I think from a neuroscientific perspective, is fundamentally concerning the possibility of neuroplasticity, that is, the possibility of change. And the fact of neuroplasticity, the fact that the brain can change in response to experience and in response to training, provides us with, at least in scientific terms, some idea about how the path of liberation might actually occur, how we might find a way out of suffering. Because if the brain can change in these ways, perhaps this provides some important insights about how suffering may actually be reduced. And so I think this is an area where there has been a terrifically important connection between the study of the brain and Buddhism. So I would like to introduce this topic with just a few facts about the brain and then some illustrations to show that when we go about our world and information comes through the senses,
Much of that information may be processed by the brain, but is not necessarily conscious. But yet it still affects the brain in important ways and can change the autonomic nervous system in ways which may influence our health. And this gives us some insight about what the role of conscious awareness might be in our minds and brains, which will be a topic that we'll consider in detail in the next few days. So one of the things that we're learning about the human brain is that it's probably the most complicated piece of matter that exists in the universe, or at least on this planet. There are more than 20,000 genes which are expressed in the brain that play a role in the activities of the brain. There are more than 100,000 distinct types of cells and constituents that we find in the brain. These are distinct physical entities that play a role in the operation of the brain. That's approximately the number of brain cells in the human brain, and this is approximately the number of connections among those brain cells. So it is a vastly complicated piece of matter, and the honest truth is that scientists have very little idea about how this actually works at this point in time. Our knowledge is really in a very early stage. There are really an astronomical number of ensembles of these are collections of cells that accomplish specific types of tasks. We don't know how many mental states there are. It could be a virtually unlimited number of mental states. Not in terms of category, episodes, yes. A millimeter cubed is approximately the size of the top of a pin. And there are approximately 20 to 30,000 neurons or brain cells in that little space of the head of a pin. There are, in that same amount of space, there are approximately 4 kilometers of axons, which are the connections between brain cells, in just the size of the tip of a pin, approximately 4 kilometers. And then there are a very large number of synapses, which are the physical connections that exist among cells in the brain. So all of this is just to emphasize that this is really, really complicated. There are a huge number of interacting parts. One of the challenges for scientists is to better understand how this all works together. And that is still very much an open question which we're at very early stages with. One of the areas of the brain, each of our neuroscientists has a favorite area of the brain that he or she studies. This is one of the areas that I study a lot. It's that little purple spot, and it's called the amygdala. You've heard, Your Holiness, about the amygdala at many other occasions, and it seems to play an important role in afflictive emotions, particularly, although it plays a role in all emotions. Now, we're beginning to learn a little bit about the connections that that area of the brain makes with other areas of the brain. And in this next slide, this depicts all of the known connections. Every one of these lines is a verified connection that exists between the amygdala, which is right in the middle, that's this area right here, and every line is a known connection between this structure and each of these numerical and letter positions represent a different part of the brain. So this is illustrating just the connections of this tiny little structure with other parts of the brain. And again, it underscores how extraordinarily interconnected this is. And again, we're still at very, very early stages of this work. Now, one of the things that neuroscientists are learning is that in a very real sense, the brain constructs our experience of reality. It does not faithfully represent the outside or the inside world, but it transforms information and represents it in this transformed way. And so what we experience in our seeing or in our hearing is not a faithful representation of what exists outside. And so, for example, we know that certain animals can hear things that humans cannot hear. We know that they can see in certain ranges of light that humans cannot see, and yet those influences are still present in humans, and some of them can still influence the brain, albeit in ways that we're not necessarily conscious of. So one of the kinds of experiments that neuroscientists do, and this is a demonstration that I showed in Delhi, and this is what we call the attentional blink, which is an experience that people have very often where something might occur in the environment and they're simply not aware of it, and it's as if their mind was not paying attention. Their mind was fixated on one thing and they were unable, therefore, to see another thing. This is an occurrence which happens a lot, and the reason why neuroscientists have become so interested in this, particularly those who are interested in the dialogue with Buddhism, is because one of the hypotheses or one of the invitations from the Buddhist tradition that we've learned is that some of these qualities that neuroscientists have studied may not necessarily be obligatory properties of the nervous system. They may be potentially trainable. That is, we may be able to actually enhance our attention in ways which allow us to see things that many people may not necessarily see. So in the attentional blink, and we can actually do this little experiment, if everyone just looks at this cross, and I will be showing a series of letters and numbers, and just pay attention to the numbers, and I'll ask which numbers that you saw. Was the number one presented? How many people saw the number one? Number two, number three, number four, five, six, seven, eight, nine. Okay. So what was actually shown is that's cheating. Yes, it plays an important role. Yes, it does play a role. Yes, absolutely. But it is a little more difficult for most people to see the seven. So the way this worked is I presented a series of letters, then the number three occurred, and then there were one or two letters, and then again the number seven. people get so excited about seeing the three that they fail to see the seven very often. So it turns out that 3 months of Vipassana meditation practice improves a person's ability to see the second number, to see the number seven. So we know this has been an important observation because it teaches us that in contrast to what neuroscientists first thought, which is that this is an obligatory property of the nervous system, that the nervous system goes into some refractory mode, where meaning that it's taking a rest. After seeing that first number, it kind of shuts down to restore itself, then it then can see the next number. What this observation suggests is that these are, at least to some extent, malleable. They're plastic. They can undergo change through training. Now, another example, scientists call change blindness. What I'm going to show here is a series of pictures. And there will be a slight change from one picture to the other. And see if you can, just by looking at these pictures very attentively, notice where the change is. So I'll show them a few times. Did anyone notice a change? I'll show it once more. Whoops, went the wrong way, sorry. I'll show it again. Now I'll show it in slower motion so that you can actually see better what changed. Now if you notice in the corner here, there was a little sign that initially in the first image was on and then it turned off. So I'll show another example. I'll show it again. And then I'll slow it down. And if you notice, there was a light at the top. I'll do it once more. The light was present, and then it went off. Now I'll show it once more so everyone can see it. The light at the top and then goes off. Most people often fail to see this change. And again, studies have shown that meditation practice, certain kinds of meditation practice, can actually influence this capacity. So another area where we see this is in detecting very subtle facial expressions. And you know your friend Paul Ekman has been one of the leading scientists in this area. And what I'd like to show now is just a couple of faces and just very quickly see what your impression is in terms of which face looks more happy or more friendly, the first or the second. So here's one. And I'll show it to you another one and tell me which looks happier, the first or the second. How many people thought the first looks happy? How many people thought the second looked happier? Okay, I'll show you what I actually displayed. So what was displayed is, and then that. So it was first a fear face, then a neutral face. And in the second case, what I displayed was this. A smiling face and then a neutral face. And so it turns out that these facial expressions can influence your judgment of a neutral face, even though you may not be aware. And one of the questions that we're investigating with the intersection of Buddhism and neuroscience is whether individuals who've trained their mind are better able to see these very fine details in these kinds of images where untrained minds may be less able to detect these very subtle differences.
That also presupposes that they have equal eyesight.
Otherwise,
We test that first. We test the eyesight. Very important. Yes. So I'd like to just end with a few additional words about the brain as a source of both delusion and insight. The idea that the brain constructs reality suggests that it never faithfully represents the external or internal worlds. And delusion, which is something that we I think can really profit from the intersection of neuroscience and Buddhism. Delusion. Distorted perception, but also potentially afflictive. So delusion can result from distortions created by emotions, which can influence our perception, our beliefs, and our expectations.
Constructivist, are you already suggesting that you are at the level of thought, or is it still construction could be taking place at the pre-conscious level?
Absolutely, pre-conscious, yes. Not necessarily at the level of thought.
Yes. She's wondering, you know, the word construction.
What time should I stop?
You know, His Holiness is relating, you know, this whole notion of construction versus faithful representation. He's trying to correlate that with the Buddhist debate about whether when mental perceptions or mental processes represent reality, is it just a one-to-one mirroring without any mediation, or whether you know, the mental processes imposes a form as a medium to kind of organize the material and perceive it. So there is that discussion. But the construction here. Okay, so then there is also just it has implications for whether what we perceive is actually kind of faithful to what is there, or whether it's a form of a distortion. Anyway.
Size illusion would be a good example.
Yes, Arthur was going to show some slides illustrating. The idea that sometimes things may look a different size, but they're actually the same size, but because of the context in which they're embedded, they can look smaller or larger.
Richie, can you just get that image there?
Sure.
Yeah, there they are. We got him. Yeah, he's got it.
This is from Arthur. Arthur, do you want to describe it? I'll be your projection man.
So, Your Holiness, you'll see here two monsters, and they're in a hallway. Which is bigger? What do you, is the first one bigger or the second one in the back bigger?
Not more the same.
Good. Okay, let's show the next slide. Oops. there's an arrow, whoop, don't go too fast. There's an arrow which is the same size here. Go slowly. All right, so I've moved the arrow, they are the same size. Most people would judge the back one to look bigger than the front one. Go to the next. Here you have three soldiers. Which soldier is taller? Most people would judge the soldier on the left to be taller than the soldier on the right. But again, that's right. Brigitte, could you go to the next? Okay, now another move, that's it. And then one more. These are actually all the same size, but as you say, Your Holiness, because of the lines that are on the, I don't know whose microphone's rustling, but because of the lines in the background, you judge the size relative to the context. All right, so what you're seeing and judging as a cognition is not a veridical or accurate representation of the physical size, but it's a subjective impression.
So because in Buddhism, Buddhist epistemological text, there's a lot of discussion of various forms of perceptual illusions and where the source of illusion lies. So this one would be categorized as the source of illusion lying in the actual context or the object. In the field.
So the object. The,
yeah, field.
Go a little further. Can you skip to the Fraser spiral, just to give a kind of fun? We'll conclude this with a final demonstration. It's called the Fraser spiral. Here, Your Holiness, one sees, most people will see a spiral where it's a kind of circle that goes in towards the center, right? Where it gets smaller and smaller. I'm going to put a spot, a star, if you hit just once, on the top. You can see the star at the top. And now we're going to move at the top of the spiral. There's a star, a red star. Yeah, okay, now we're going to move it around the spiral and follow it. Notice it goes to the same place. You can go back if you want and then forward again, just backwards. And that's it, there it goes again. So if you trace your finger around the spiral, it's not a spiral, it's actually a circle.
Same distance, right?
Same distance, yeah. It's
the spiral.
You see a spiral, but if you draw your finger, you move your finger, it's only a circle.
So in
reality, on the right-hand side in the lower, you'll see that there's a series of concentric circles in the lower right.
So it's basically a concentric circle.
It's a set of concentric circles.
No difference in
no
the
difference,
distance.
No difference, yeah. Because of the context.
The gap, the background.
So this is, you know, is some evidence concerning the relation between perception and cognition. You know, what is it one sees? What is it one cognizes and knows? It raises many interesting philosophical issues.
Your Holiness, I wanted to just review another very important point that some scientists have called mental time travel. What we mean by that is that human beings have the capacity to reflect about the future and also to reflect on the past. A very well-known neuroscientist who you've met, Your Holiness, at Stanford, by the name of Robert Sapolsky wrote a very famous book called Why Zebras Don't Get Ulcers. And the idea that is captured there is that because human beings have the capacity to reflect on the past and anticipate the future, they spend a considerable amount of time worrying, ruminating about the past, and worrying about events that may occur in the future rather than being in the present moment. In fact, a recent scientific study observed in a large sample of American adults, approximately 47% of their waking time, they were not actually attending to what they were doing. Their mind was wandering. They were either ruminating about the past or anticipating the future. They actually, 47% of the time, they were not focused on what they were doing.
So if you're in that wandering mind state, so you can't achieve much. For example, you can't study well or do any research.
That may be a significant contributor to the problems in education in the United States. Why we're number 27 in educational success and achievement. We think it may be a very big problem.
So Solon is wondering whether that research has taken into account the difference of television viewing habit of, say, for example, people in the urban areas in the United States and the rural areas. Are you aware of that?
All of these individuals in the United States, in both rural and urban areas, there would be access to television. I don't think television exposure necessarily.
So for example, like an artist would be so focused.
So the profession?
Yes.
Artist?
Yes.
I think most of his or her work is to concentrate. So such people also support
the fall into this category of 47%?
We don't know the answer to that. I think that this is based on about 5,000 individuals, so it's representative, but there's a lot of variation among people. But I think even if you asked academics who are very focused in their work, have we had experiences reading a book, for example, where we're reading a book and we turn a page and not actually know what was on the page that we just read? I think if we're really honest with ourselves, many of us have had that experience of the mind.
So it's only saying that if scientists acquire that kind of habits, then it's slightly worrying.
It's a disaster.
Then you will never find the reality.
The reason I bring this issue up in a neuroscientific context is because the prefrontal cortex, this very large mass, which actually over the course of evolution has grown the most in human beings compared to any other species. So if you look at the relation between the size of the prefrontal cortex in relation to the remainder of the brain mass, that ratio is larger in humans than it is in any other species. And scientists believe that it's because of the evolution of the prefrontal cortex that allows us to anticipate the future as well as to reflect on the past. Those are skills which clearly are beneficial for many things that we do, but they also can get us into trouble. And that is why we are more likely to get ulcers than zebras, because we have the capacity to worry about the future and ruminate about the past in a way that other species do not. And it is because of the evolution of the prefrontal cortex. It has given us that ability, but it also gets us into difficulties because of that. So, Your Holiness, I will.
Mind wandering,
Or are they the same?
Well, they're it.
For example, like you know, if we are trying to focus on something, you get distracted, and the object of your distraction maybe can be anything, but the mind just loses its focus and gets distracted.
Well, we would make a distinction among certain kinds of distractors. So for example, you can be distracted by a sound. If you heard your name being called, you can orient, you focus your attention. That's a certain kind of distraction. Then what the kind of distraction that we're talking about is more of an internal distraction. It's a distraction from our thoughts and our emotions, which pull us either to the future or to the past.
Because the senses, you know, the senses versus the thoughts, the senses are very present oriented. They cannot turn back or project into the future. So it's really a thought at the level
of
thought.
Yes, exactly. So one of the questions which is so important in this area of research is whether the contemplative traditions may have some useful exercises for us or useful strategies for, in some sense, harnessing the potential that human beings are born with to use them for more constructive purposes. So rather than getting distracted in this way and having our minds wander to harness that capacity for specific beneficial purposes in a focused way. And so one of the areas of active investigation in what we call contemplative neuroscience is how contemplative practices may influence this area of the brain, the prefrontal cortex, in ways which enable this area of the brain to work in a way which is more beneficial rather than being afflictive. So I will end here, and I can just end with a question for Your Holiness about whether there are specific elements or strategies in the Buddhist tradition which you think would be particularly applicable in this context for that scientists might investigate in this area.
Yeah. So you have already done quite a bit of research on, adept meditators. So His Holiness is wondering.
So meditator, no matter what object, is supposed to see training, the mind focusing
yes.
on single point of
sorrow. Way long.
Yes. Yes, and this has been a very fruitful area of scientific investigation. And now there are several very good studies published in the scientific literature that show that certain types of meditation can be beneficial in focusing the mind in this way and may reduce the propensity of human beings to show this mind wandering. It may help focus the mind in that way. There's still so many questions and about how this area of the brain, the prefrontal cortex, is influenced. And also, what I wanted to end on is really the big questions, which still are as mysterious as they were at the very beginning of this enterprise, which is, how is it that our experience may actually emerge out of the neural matter that constitutes our brain, which of course is a conjecture, a hypothesis, or a bias that neuroscientists often begin with. That is a question that still is as mysterious as it was two or three centuries ago. We also have very little sense of whether it may be possible for consciousness to exist without this material substrate, and this is an issue, or at least without the material substrate that is the conventional material substrate that neuroscientists believe is the key to understanding consciousness. That's an issue that we know almost nothing about. And so one of the things I find most helpful in my own laboratory is just for us all to remind ourselves about these big questions that we know so little about, to help cultivate a little bit more humility as we navigate this difficult set of questions.
So, Your Holiness, if we were in your living room, in Dharamsala, gathered around a table in an intimate conversation, and you had just heard from these two colleagues about how very complicated their topics are, what would you ask them to go away and do? What charge would you give them as they...
The area where we need more inspiration is the distinction between conceptual and non-conceptual consciousness. And also sense consciousness. We have a position that on the level of conceptual thought, the appearance and the conceptualization kind of become blended, whereas that's not the case on the faculties, on the sense faculties. So in this regard, an area to investigate would be that of sleep state, because that's free from conceptual thoughts, yet that's an area where it is purely non-sensory, non-sensorial, and yet at the same time where thoughts have a play. And so it would be interesting to look at that area and then see whether one could come up with
a greater, clear understanding of the distinction between the conceptual mental processes and processes that are not conceptual, not thought-related. So this is an important...
Now, senses of organs are the conceptual memory.
So, for example, like all the sensory experiences in the Buddhist epistemology are seen to be beyond the level of thought. So it's it's not a conceptual process, it's a sensory process.
Here, when I look at the paper in front of me, it sees only whatever is presented there up front and cannot see things go little past or in coming in the future, whereas that's not the case.
One personal visual perception of this booklet on the table right now, what the visual perception really perceives is this very particular, you know, present moment existence of that object on the table, that book. Whereas when you close your eyes and you think about this book, then you're at the level of thought, in the realm of thought, where then there is a conflation of time and space. So then you're no longer focused on a particular, you know, phenomenon. So there is that distinction.
Mm.
So it's almost like saying that, you know, one possible occasion for a good opportunity for research is, you know, in the dream state when someone is sleeping, because during that state, most of the all the sensory modalities are quietened. So whatever process that's happening would be at the level of this mental, not sensory. You know, visual sensory and auditory, they're all kind of switched off. And then furthermore, if you go down to the deepest sleep level, then again one would expect, you know, different mental processes. Therefore, you know, if one can see the brain signatures and the differences in the brain activity, you know, that might actually show us a better way of teasing out what are the specific unique signatures of... So in sleep, the sensory modalities are not active. So whatever mental processes that's occurring is really in the domain of mental realm. So, Richie, you spoke about, alluded to the difficulty of accounting for the interaction between the physical substrate and the conscious experience that arising out of it. Here also, in the classical Indian tradition, there is a recognition that certain forms of yogic practices, not in the physical sense, but the yogic practices that employ physical processes of, you know, flow of energy and so on, have impact upon the mental states of the yogi, meditator. At the same time, the experience of the meditator has an impact on that physical processes. So there is a, you know, bi-directional
effect.
So, you know, in the Buddhist or classical Indian text, you know, when many of the mental processes, especially in relation to the physical substrate, are explained in terms of, in the Vajrayana text, in terms of the different energy centers or the chakras, and there's a lot of detailed descriptions of this. But if you look at the neuroscience explanation with all those zillions of numbers up there, so it would be an interesting area to try to somehow, you know, correlate the two and see how, you know, where it leads to.
Yeah, on the issue of sleep, on the issue of
this microphone. Yeah. On the issue of sleep, one of the things that we do know a little bit about is during dreaming sleep, even though information is not coming through the senses, the brain systems which are involved in sensation are extremely active. So it's as if the brain is creating the those sensations internally, which is how scientists understand the experience of a dreamer in seeing things or hearing things. Those sensory, the neural
centers, the neural circuits involved in those sensory representations are very active during dreaming sleep.
So that seems to be, actually that should be the case, because although when we are in sleep, the sensory modalities are inactive, but if someone shouts loudly next to you, you know, we wake up and hear it.
So. So
although it may not be active, but there seems to be at least the potential, active potential there. So now, what kind of language we need to use here from the Buddhist epistemological point of view, whether to say it's not active, but it's in a sort of a
potential
form, or whether it's not conscious, but it's in a subconscious form.
So
for example, if someone is sleeping in the dark, and then as a result of someone switching off on the light, can it cause the person to wake up? Yes.
Sure.
So then it's the same as the auditory stimulus.
And speaking of our senses and signals to our senses, I think I heard the bell for lunch. So we are well begun. This is just the beginning of our time together. We will come back after lunch at 1 o'clock.
1:30.
I'm sorry, 1:30. Yes, thank you. At 1:30.
1.
No, 1 o'clock.
I'm sorry. Yeah. I'm confusing it.
1 o'clock, after lunch at 1 o'clock, we'll have four speakers, including Jinpo will step out of his role as translator and into his role as philosopher and scholar, and will give us a wonderful talk on the bridges between these two traditions. So we're looking forward to that. Your Holiness, thank you so much for your time this morning.